during the last speech. I think people are food's digesting still from Iftar. Assalamualaikum. Assalamualaikum. Thank you. It's really comforting to see all of you here tonight. And I'll tell you the reason why is because last week I got a phone call from one of the sisters and she told me that there was a lot of negative comments being posted on Facebook when the advertising started for this event. And I thought that was really unfortunate because a lot of people were questioning, why are you having this event for Haiti? And why are you doing this? Because we've done enough for them already. There's three things that those people should keep in mind. One of them is that people need to understand that, I know that a lot of people are upset because, you know, thousands and thousands and millions of dollars was donated to Haiti. So people think that we've done enough for these people and there's they received enough and we should, don't have to give to them anymore. But also because people are wondering where that money has gone. The Haitian people are also asking the same question. They want to know where all that money that's been donated, where it's gone. Because the fact of the matter is, their situation has not changed since the earthquake. The other thing that they need to remember is that, you know, this statement is, we've done enough for them. And if you're going to use that same logic towards other countries, then we shouldn't be sending money to Africa. We shouldn't, because aid has been going there for the last few decades. And we shouldn't be sending money to Lebanon or Afghanistan or Iraq. Why are we bothering to build orphanages and hospitals and schools in Iraq? We've been sending money there since 2003. So if that's our logic, then why are we continuing to help these other countries and Pakistan? We can't use this logic because this is an injustice for us to talk like this. Especially from the mouths of Muslims who call themselves followers of the Ahlul Bayt. Because we know that these godly people would give until they had nothing left to offer. And we should never allow an opportunity to help others pass us by. Also, if one is to have an attitude such as this, then one has to accept this type or this way of thinking for themselves as well. They should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put a time limit on the sustenance that He provides to them. Anyway, I spoke to Brother Shoaib yesterday, and I mentioned, you know, these statements to him, and I said, how would you respond to this? And basically, he just laughed. He said, first of all, the brothers and sisters in Haiti, they don't have enough money to pay their homes, or the zakat, or sadaqah. There's no jobs in Haiti. He says, basically, we don't have enough money to sustain ourselves. And we are depending on those who have more to help us until we get up on our feet. He also said, I invite all of those people who made these comments to come to Haiti and visit us and see how we live. He said, come to Haiti and meet us. So I'm going to do just that. I'm going to introduce you to Brother Shoaib. So when you meet those people, you can tell them about the school or the community in Haiti yourselves. And inshallah, we can start to rid our community of the negative comments. Brother Shoaib is of small stature, but has a big heart. He was born and raised in Haiti, and his primary focus is Islam, and the second is education. With a full scholarship, he attained his associate degree in science of education at Suffolk University in Boston. He spent 6 months studying the fundamentals of religion in Trinidad, and he spent 4 years studying the Jaffrey School of Thought under Sheikh Khalilu. Initially, he worked as a teacher in different colleges and universities when he returned to Haiti from the U.S. And it was during this time that he became increasingly concerned about the number of homeless children in his country. And he started toying with the idea of opening an Islamic center. And he knew that in order to change the Haitian society, the children had to receive an education. One day, a woman named Claudette Julian informed her that her husband had died and left her with 2 young boys that she couldn't support. And she asked him if he would take her kids. And he said he would on the condition that she allowed him to teach than his religion, which is Islam. She agreed to this. So with these two boys and three other boys that were living in the streets, he started this school. And with a loan of $1,300, the Almaty Center was officially opened in a home in September 2000. Not long after, he was feeding, clothing, and educating 9 children. Today, the school has 160 kids. And they recently sent 17 children for their board of education exams, and all of them passed except one. Now they will be able to go on to junior high. Bashway is working for the government in the public works department. With his paycheck, that of his wife's, sporadic donations, and some school fees, he sustained the school and paid the teacher's salaries. Not long ago, Shoaib was advised that he would be transferred to another city, which was 8 hours away from Port-au-Prince. He had to make a decision whether he wanted to keep his material work or do his spiritual work. So he kept his spiritual job and he left the government. I met Brother Shoaib through the Revert Muslim Association approximately 3 years ago, and I have been communicating with him on and off ever since then. I received 2 emails from him, one on January 8th and the other one on January 11th, 2010. And then the earthquake hit on the 12th. It was approximately 7 to 10 days before my friend and me was able to reach Shoaib, and this was the email that he sent to me. I was finally able to get in touch with Brother Shoaib, and he told me about his experiences during the earthquake and the needs of the community. One of the things that he told me was that when the earthquake hit, he was in the mountains. And he said that he was standing on the mountain, and just over there, there was a drop, and in between, and then there was another mountain. And in between these two mountains, there was a body of water, and there was a group of people who were working down there. And he said that when the earthquake hit, the two mountains, they came together. So I said, well, what happened to the people that were down there? He said they were crushed between the two mountains. He said, honestly, sister, he said, I thought this was the day of Qiyamah. It took him 3 or 4 days to walk back to his house, and he saw the devastation and the destruction, and there was dead bodies in the streets, and he finally made it to his home where he found his wife sitting under a table as she was too scared to come outside. I was talking about how the Muslim community responded to the earthquake. First of all, there was 2 sisters who immediately organized a movie night in Masjid Ahlul Bayt in the MYM room. With the support of many sisters and brothers, they managed to raise over $1,000. Then the Path of Light decided to send a container and started collecting clothing, money, and non-perishable items. And we raised approximately $8,000 with donations from Montreal, Toronto, Ottawa, Kitchener, the Middle East, UK, and the US. Shane Haiti donated lots of money, clothing, food, and other items. Masjid Ahlul Bayt gave their money, clothing, goods, and most importantly, they gave their center. The Lebanese community also donated money and clothing. And there was a group of sisters who worked every weekend for 2 months straight, sorting clothes, packing, folding, and a group of brothers who loaded the container. And the Montreal Muslim community was the first community to send a container to Brother Shoaib and the Haitian Muslims down there. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. The container was packed with toiletry items, clothing, food, tents, school supplies, shoes, purses, hair products, blankets, towels, and basically anything that we could pack. These were basically the goods that were received at the court in Haiti. And these are the goods that are being distributed to the people in Haiti. Also, every once in a while, we would send money to British Way and ask them to just take care of the people's needs, whatever it was that they needed. So this time we told him, we sent money to him and we told him to just, you know, have an open banquet and feed the people. He said that at this reception they were able to feed 200 people, and he said normally when food is involved, people get out of control, but alhamdulillah, everything went well with this distribution. One of the other things that the Montreal community did was that they were able to provide bookshelves for him so that they could have bookshelves for all their literature and then for their little library, because normally all their books are kept on the floor. Now I'm going to speak to you quickly about my trip to Haiti. There were 10 of us who traveled together. There were sister communities from the World Federation who went to do a needs assessment of the community, and there was a dentist, Hassan Dalji, and his family from the Global Kindness Foundation, and they were on a dental mission. We arrived on June 17th. It was my son, my niece, sister Kenise, and myself were on the same flight. But we weren't sitting together. So as me and my son, we disembarked, we were waiting for sister Kenise to come out. And when she finally arrived, she told me that she had been sitting with a foreign aid worker, and he told her that Haiti was worse than Gaza. So she looked at me and she said, "What do you want to do?" I said, "Well, our tickets are paid for and we're here at the airport, let's go." So we went outside and we met Brother Shuey and the rest of the dental team and our drivers, and Brother Shuey said, "Welcome to Haiti." So as you can see, these people after a year and a half are still living in these tents. And this is a common scene around the city where there's basically it's just garbage because there's no garbage collection, so the stuff is just laying out there. And usually you can smell the strong scent of people burning garbage because it's the only way for them to get rid of all the refuse. This year is the first day of our dental mission. The municipal electricity is very sporadic. They might get electricity maybe 2 or 3 hours per day. So Brother Hassanin, he brought this generator, and as you can see, his son is down here trying to figure out how to work it. So we didn't have any electricity for a little while, and then there was a brother who came and he said that there was electricity and they connect the wires to each other, and then finally we were able to do some dental work. The first day we had to work outside. This is, he's mentioning that we were working under a fire ant tree. There's all these little red ants that were on the leaves of the tree, and they would just fall on you, and then they would come and bite you really hard. So these are some of the conditions under which we were working. This is Brother Hassanin from Vancouver, and this is his wife, Sister Fatima. And that there's Sister Fatima, the wife of Brother Shuey. Obviously, we were coming there with new equipment, and your strangers should be outside. So in order to try and get the trust of the kids, we try to play with them and talk to them, and we play games with them. And here, Brother Hassanin is showing them Toy Story on his computer. Here, his wife was reading a book to the children, and you can see the translation. We usually went from English to French to Creole. This is just working with the kids, providing dental work to them. As you saw in the beginning, the difference between how the center looked before and how it looks now. This is their mess kit, and it's also where the kids eat, and this is a little storage area. Here's some of the kids, and up there you can see it's their blackboard. As you can see over here, there's basically no wall. It's basically plywood, which is different from how it was before. These are the teacher's desk and the kids, the students' desk. And here there's two classrooms. There's one right here, there's another one behind that piece of plywood. So basically you have, this situation, there's six classrooms, pretty much set up like this, and there's no sound barriers, so you just hear noise between all the classrooms. Here on the last day, and make up for all the pain that we inflicted on these children. We gave them some toys and gifts, so they were happy to see us. And here's just some of the people from the dental team making friends with their kids. So the last day that we were there, just took a picture outside with the whole team and Brother Shoaib and our driver. And as you can see, he's talking about how much dental work was done. They treated 75 patients and 4 locations, and the approximate value of the work that was done was about $38,000. This is right beside Brother Shoaib School. So when you come out, that sign where we were standing, when you come out, this is what's to the left of the school. As you can see, nothing's really changed. No major cleanup has happened. This is pretty much the scene on most of the streets there. This is the main watering hole in Carrefour, where Brother Shoaib School is. This is literally a minute walk away from the school. And as you can see, the people come here to bathe, to wash their clothes, and to drink. And just further up, there's a little hill from where the water is coming. And there's a rusted truck that the water goes through there before it gets down into this watering hole. So this is the situation. So one of the things that we were thinking about is the proceeds tonight could go towards building a water well for this community. These are just some of Brother Shoaib's future goals. As I said, he has a big vision. He would like to, you know, be able to provide 3 meals a day to the children. As of right now, most of the children only eat whatever they provide to them at the school, which is 1 meal a day. And he said that if they're able to provide them with 3 meals a day, it would help them to concentrate and focus. They'd be able to do more physical activities, and it would protect them against certain illnesses. He also wants to build a proper orphanage because there's a lot of children who are living on the streets. There's approximately, like I said, there's 160 children at the school, 70% of them are orphans. He wants to take as many children off the street, provide them with proper shelter and food and clothing, and inshallah open up a high school and enroll more children. He said it doesn't matter how many schools are in the area, there's just not enough to fulfill all the needs of all the children that are in Haiti. And one of the other things that he would like to do is to open a medical clinic for the children and the rest of the community, because obviously these people are basically in survival mode, and medicine is the last of their priority list. They're just trying to make enough money to eat and live for the day. This message from Brother Shoaib and the children after they received their goods from the container, just sending a thank you to all the Muslims in Montreal and Toronto. And that's it. Thank you so much for your time. I know that a lot of people are upset because, you know, thousands and thousands and millions of dollars was donated to Haiti. So people think that we've done enough for these people, and there's you know, they received enough and we should, don't have to give to them anymore. But also because people are wondering where that money has gone. The Haitian people are also asking the same question. They want to know where all that money that's during the last week. I think people are food digesting still from Iftar. Assalamualaikum. Assalamualaikum. Thank you. It's really comforting to see all of you here tonight, and tell you the reason why is because last week I got a phone call from one of the sisters, and she told me that there was a lot of negatives in donating where it's gone, because the fact of the matter is that their situation has not changed since the earthquake. The other thing that they need to remember is that, you know, this statement is, we've done enough for them. And if you're going to use that same logic towards other countries, then we should be sending money to Africa. We shouldn't, because aid has been going there for the last few decades. And we shouldn't be sending money to Lebanon. With comments being posted on Facebook when the advertising started for this event. And I thought that was really unfortunate, because a lot of people were questioning, why are you having this event for Haiti? And why are you doing this? Because we've done enough for them already. There's three things that those people should keep in mind. One of them is that people need to understand that Afghanistan or Iraq, why are we bothering to build orphanages and hospitals and schools in Iraq? We've been sending money there since 2003. So if that's our logic, then why are we continuing to help these other countries and Pakistan? We can't use this logic because this is an injustice for us to talk like this. Especially from the mouths of Muslims who call themselves